Everybody knows how much society loves a good conspiracy theory, especially when it comes to sports. Sometimes there's no basis to them, but other times, there's just too much evidence to ignore. Here are the 10 most controversial moments in NFL history. Super Bowl 40. Looking at the final score from Super Bowl 40 between the Pittsburgh Steelers and the Seattle Seahawks, it would seem like there shouldn't be much controversy here. The Steelers easily won 21-10, but that score doesn't tell the full story. The Seahawks were flagged on multiple occasions on controversial, crucial calls. It looked like the Seahawks were playing against both the Steelers and the officials that night. Typically, people usually attribute claims such as these to emotions from fans who are mad their team lost or despise the other team. Well, that all changed with this situation when a referee from the game, Bill Levy, opened up about his performance officiating that contest 4 years later. Levy said, "I kicked two calls in the fourth quarter, and I impacted the game, and as an official, you never want to do that. It left me with a lot of sleepless nights, and I think about it constantly. I'll go to my grave wishing that I'd been better." While this implies that there was no malintent, it confirms that Seattle was robbed, and the Seahawks fans have every right to be sour about what transpired in Detroit in 2006. I'm not sure if this makes the Seattle faithful feel better or worse, though. 2018 NFC Championship Game. With under 2 minutes to play in the fourth quarter of the 2018 NFC Championship game between the New Orleans Saints and the Los Angeles Rams, the score was tied 20-20. Drew Brees and the squad faced the critical 3rd and 10 from the LA 13-yard line. Brees found his wide receiver Tommy Lee Lewis on a wheel route. Lewis would have at least had the first down and probably a touchdown had he caught the pass. So Rams cornerback Nickel Roby Coleman decided to just lay out Lewis to prevent him from making the catch. Watching it live, it was clearly defensive pass interference, and the Saints would be in prime position to either run out the clock and kick the game-winning field goal or score a touchdown. Except, the flag never came. All 73,000 Saints fans in attendance let the refs know how they felt about the missed call, as did New Orleans head coach Sean Payton. His team was forced to settle for a field goal and left enough time for the Rams to drive down the field and kick a field goal of their own to send the game into overtime, where LA would win and punch their ticket to the Super Bowl. Roby Coleman later said, "Yes, I got there too early. I was beat, and I was trying to save the touchdown." Well, he ended up saving his team's season and temporarily changing the NFL. It was such an egregious missed call that the league implemented a new rule the following season, where teams could challenge plays involving potential pass interference. Additionally, a judge in Louisiana ordered Roger Goodell and three officials to testify over the no call. An attorney filed suit over the game seeking $75,000 in damages to be donated to charity. Super Bowl III. The Baltimore Colts came into Super Bowl III as heavy favorites against the New York Jets. The Colts were 13-1 and had only scored under 20 points once all season as they were led by league MVP Earl Morrall. Morrall and his Colts were upset by the Jets 16-7 as Morrall completed just 6 of his 17 passes and threw 3 interceptions. It seemed as though the Colts had intentionally thrown the game. You're probably wondering, why would a team ever intentionally lose in the Super Bowl? But there are actually a couple of theories explaining why. Some people believe that the Colts were paid off to not put forth any effort to help make the AFL look legitimate, because at that time there were two separate leagues, the National Football League, NFL, and the American Football League, AFL. By making the AFL seem more competitive after 2 blowout losses in the first 2 Super Bowls, they could come together and form the NFL that we know today. Another theory comes from Colts star defensive lineman Bubba Smith, who claimed in his autobiography that the game was fixed by a bookmaker in New York and members of the NFL Players Association. Dez caught it. With 5 minutes left in a 2014 divisional round matchup between the Dallas Cowboys and the Green Bay Packers, the Packers were holding on to a 25-21 lead. Facing a 4th-and-2 from the Green Bay 32, Tony Romo found his wide receiver Dez Bryant streaking down the left sideline, and Bryant made a sensational leaping grab over the Green Bay defender Sam Shields right around the goal line. Green Bay challenged the catch, and the call was overturned, much to the surprise of anyone watching the game. After being initially ruled a catch on the field and needing conclusive evidence to overturn the original call, it didn't seem like there was nearly enough to overturn it. Instead of 1st and goal from the 1, it was a Dallas turnover and they went on to lose the game. 3 years after the incident, the NFL Competition Committee unanimously agreed that Dez did, in fact, catch it. It's a phrase that will forever be tied to the legacies of Bryant and Romo and an everlasting running joke on social media. Super Bowl 36. The controversy involving Super Bowl 36 between the New England Patriots and the St. Louis Rams did not actually occur during the game. It happened leading up to it, as the Patriots allegedly taped a walkthrough practice conducted by the Rams. The Rams' offense, which was one of the greatest in NFL history, was held to just 17 points in the game, giving people even more reason to believe the Patriots knew a bit extra about the St. Louis playbook. When it looked like the Rams and Patriots were going to meet in another Super Bowl, in Super Bowl 53, former Rams Hall of Fame running back Eric Dickerson said, "We want a rematch against the Patriots. We want them back again because they cheated us. They cheated us. They cheated us. They know they cheated us back in New Orleans. They watched our film, so we want some more of them." Another Hall of Fame running back for the Rams is just as salty about the incident. In 2013, 11 years after the game, Marshall Faulk said, "Am I over the loss? Yeah, I'm over the loss. But I'll never be over being cheated out of the Super Bowl. That's a different story." The Tuck Rule Game. As much as Patriots fans love the narrative that Roger Goodell and the NFL are out to get them, here they are again on this list, benefiting from additional aid. In a 2002 AFC Divisional Round matchup, the Oakland Raiders led the Pats 13-10 late in the fourth quarter. New England was driving when Oakland defensive back Charles Woodson hit Tom Brady, forcing him to drop the ball. The Raiders fell on the ball, and the play was initially ruled a fumble on the field, likely ending the game. The play was reviewed and overturned, as the officials cited a rule that nobody had ever heard of until that play, called the Tuck Rule. They determined that because Brady had been bringing the ball forward before attempting to bring it back down into his body, the play should be ruled as an incomplete pass. The Pats ended up winning the game and going on to win the Super Bowl. But people still wonder whether or not that call would have been made for any other quarterback or franchise. Power outage in the Super Bowl. With the Baltimore Ravens leading the San Francisco 49ers 28-6 in the third quarter, it seemed like Super Bowl 47 was about to be a blowout. Nothing could stop the Ravens that night, except for the lights going out. The power went out and the momentum shifted as the 49ers then went on a run to make the score 28-23. While league officials said it was a shoddy relay that caused the outage, Ravens players weren't buying it. Ray Lewis said, "You're a zillion-dollar company and your lights go out? No way." Now listen, if you grew up like I grew up, and you grew up in a household like I grew up, then sometimes your lights might go out, because times get hard. I understand that. But you cannot tell me somebody wasn't sitting there, and when they say, "The Ravens are about to blow them out, man, we better do something." Lewis's fellow linebacker Terrell Suggs agreed, as he also said, "I was like, ah, Roger Goodell. He never stops. He always has something up his sleeve. He just couldn't let us have this one in a landslide, huh? I thought he had a hand in it." Most definitely he had a hand in it. Either way, Lewis, Suggs, and the Ravens got their rings as they went on to win the game 34-31. The Fail Mary. In 2012, NFL referees participated in a lockout. Insert replacement officials and one of the biggest officiating gaffes in not just NFL history, but maybe in all of sports. In a Week 3 Monday Night Football contest between the Green Bay Packers and Seattle Seahawks, the game ended with a Hail Mary from Russell Wilson. He found his wide receiver Golden Tate in the end zone. Or did he? One replacement official ruled touchdown, while another signaled touchback for an interception, all while it appeared Packer defensive back M.D. Jennings may have had possession of the ball. Additionally, Tate clearly pushed off to make the catch and should have been called for offensive pass interference. The officials conferred and ruled it a touchdown, giving the Seahawks the win in a play known as the Fail Mary or the inaccurate reception. 2 days later, the NFL and NFL Referees Association announced they had reached an agreement to end the lockout. I guess this all-time embarrassing moment for the league brought the two parties together. If it means never seeing replacement referees in another game, I'm glad this happened. Sorry, Green Bay fans. Bottlegate. Usually the Cleveland Browns are the ones making their lives harder with poor draft choices or head coaching hires, but in this case, they got robbed by the officials. In 2001, the Browns were 6-6 and desperately needed a win against the Jacksonville Jaguars to keep their playoff hopes alive. After trailing 15-10 with just over a minute left in the game, Cleveland faced a 4th-and-2 from the Jacksonville 12-yard line. Browns quarterback Tim Couch found his wide receiver Quincy Morgan across the middle for a short gain and a first down. It appeared Morgan may have dropped the ball, though, but Cleveland hurried to the line and spiked the ball. After the spike, the officials then decided to go back and review the 4th-down play, even though another play had already taken place. The rules clearly state you cannot review a play after another one has occurred, but the refs did it anyway and saw Morgan drop the ball. They announced it would be Jacksonville's ball, essentially ending the game. having seen their franchise taken away in 1995 and not making the playoffs since the team's return in 1999, the Browns fans did not handle this decision or action by the officials well. Some fans ran on the field in protest, and others threw bottles onto the field. They were so out of hand that the officials decided to call the game early, with 48 seconds remaining, in a move that had never been done before in NFL history. After both teams departed the field, the league then made them come back and finish the game as Jacksonville kneeled the ball. 2014 NFC Wildcard Game. The Dez caught it game actually may not have ever happened if it wasn't for this game, as the Cowboys had to beat the Detroit Lions in the wildcard game to face Green Bay in the divisional round. Looking to potentially ice the game, Detroit faced a 3rd-and-1 from the Dallas 46-yard line with 8:25 remaining, holding a 20-17 lead. The Lions run a play action, and Matthew Stafford finds his tight end Brandon Pettigrew down the field, but he underthrows the ball, and Dallas linebacker Anthony Hitchens gets in Pettigrew's way as he attempts to turn and catch it. Hitchens made contact with the tight end and never turned his head around to look for the ball, so a flag for defensive pass interference was thrown and announced by the head referee Pete Morelli. Then Morelli made another announcement, saying the flag was actually being picked up. Watching it live and seeing the replay, it seemed like clear defensive pass interference, so there was confusion as to what changed to make him pick up the flag. After the game, Morelli explained, "The back judge threw his flag for defensive pass interference. We got other information from another official from a different angle that thought the contact was minimal and didn't warrant pass interference. He thought it was face guarding." It was strange, to say the least, that the back judge was talked out of making the call because it seemed he had a good angle on the play. Additionally, replay showed that the defender grabbed the tight end before the ball got there, making it irrelevant that he was face guarding. The call completely changed the game, as Dallas went on to win 24-20. I guess karma came knocking the next game, though, as Dez's catch was inexplicably ruled incomplete.